Give me a moment to become live on the website.
Shall we start?
All of us stay unmuted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we are starting, sir. Okay. Very good afternoon, dear friends. We are going to organize this second webinar of OrthoWorld's Ortho Team and Bihar Orthopedic Association. The first meeting was on arthroscopy. This is on the spine. We have a very good national faculty in the spine. The focus will be cervical spine trauma and the diseases. So now I'm handing over to our BOA President, Dr. Manoj Chaudhary. Say a word.
Thank you, Shamsul. And welcome, dear viewers. We are now ready for our second live webinar on cervical spinal trauma. We have tried our best to make it very interesting and very interactive. And for this, we have allocated one full hour for discussion. So you may participate by asking questions, by texting to Dr. Ashok Shyam or Dr. Shamsul Hoda. This webinar is a collective effort of our members and everyone involved deserves appreciation. My special thanks goes to Dr. Shamsul Hoda, Dr. Ashok Shyam, Dr. Rajiv Anand, and Dr. Rakesh Chaudhary. Now I am handing over to Dr. Rajiv Anand, who will be coordinating.
Thank you very much, sir, and good afternoon to everyone. All the viewers of Bihar Orthopedic Association, I welcome you all. And this is our second webinar, as everyone has said. The first was an arthroscopy, and the second one is cervical spine trauma, as well as the cervical disc diseases. So let me introduce our speakers. Dr. Abhay Nele is from Mumbai. And I think everyone can see Dr. Abhay Nele. Dr. Gautam from HMRI Paris, and Dr. V.K. Sinha is in the head of the department, Patna Medical College, Department of Orthopedics, and he is organizing secretary of ASICON 2021 this next year as well. So Dr. Raghu Prasad, he is also from Mumbai, he's a consultant spinal surgeon from Mumbai. And with us, Dr. Ranjit Mundakrishnan, he is a consultant orthopedic surgeon from Trivandrum. So they all are panelists, and Dr. Shamsul Hoda will be coordinating and I'll be moderating the session. I'm Dr. Rajiv Anand, and with us, our president, Bihar Orthopedic Association is there, and we all will participate in discussion. So without wasting much of the time, I'll just invite Dr. Abhay Nene, and we will be talking on cervical disc disease. Dr. Abhay Nene, please.
Thank you so much. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes, sir. Please go on.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. The brief is to actually discuss cervical disc disease, and the reason to discuss this is because you can see these four cases on the screen. They all are acute cervical disc prolapse with radiculopathy. But if you see the types of treatment that happens, is completely different in different situations. So I'm bringing to light the fact that there is very little consensus on who does what to a similar problem. And different people and different surgeons and different institutes will do anything ranging from nothing, like conservative treatment, to a disc replacement or even an ACF. We don't have a good protocol in place, and no matter how much you delve into yourself, you yourself will not have a pattern of treatment. You will keep wavering when you look at dig out your last 15 cases of cervical disc prolapse. You know, you may not have followed a specific protocol. So here we are, and let's discuss this in a case-based scenario, because this will make it more familiar to your outpatient profile. So our first patient is a young dentist, and she comes with a sudden severe trapezitis, like a locked neck. And most people come and say muscular dard ho raha hai, muscle spasm hai. That's how they present. And sure enough, even with the IQ of a dentist, she didn't go to a doctor. She went to a physical therapist, which is again the norm, because they are more easily available, they're next door, and they're less scary people to go to. So our patients first go to the physical therapist, who in their wisdom do whatever they have been taught. They are not bad guys, but they just have a limitation in the training. And she was treated with traction. Now, I'm putting this across because this is a very common scenario, and I'm more than happy for any of you all to just press the yellow button and barge in and ask questions or make a comment. This is not a one-way lecture. I'm hoping it to be a discussion. So obviously, after traction, the protective muscle spasm, which was holding her disc together, was released. She felt great, but in a few hours, she developed a radiculopathy. And how often do you see that in practice? Because the spasm, which was hurting her, was actually saving her disc from further prolapse. And the minute the spasm was released, she came with a conventional nerve compression with radiculopathy. And now she had lancinating radicular pain. And everyone knows that this was a neuralgia. And on examination, she also had a triceps weakness. So at this point, may I bring Dr. Shamsul in on the discussion and ask him what his immediate plan in his practice setting be here. Dr. Huda, you'll have to unmute yourself. You can press the space bar and you'll become unmute. Yeah.
Sorry, sir, I couldn't hear you, sir.
Yeah, what would your plan be in your practice setting? A young dentist, short history, acute radiculopathy, MRI showing a foraminal disc.
Okay, sir. In this case, sir, I'm not doing very much of cervical spine, sir. But sure. First, I'd like to go conservative only in this case.
Sure. Gautam, can you tell us the protocol that you adopt in your practice, Dr. Gautam Prasad?
Yeah. So, if there is no significant weakness, am I audible, sir? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, if there is no significant weakness.
There's triceps weakness of the non-dominant hand, grade 3 by 5.
First, some pregabalin or gabapentin group and a soft cervical collar.
Right.
Would like to watch her for next, a week or two, and then take it from there.
Right, great. So I think both of you reflected the same opinion that most of us have, and that literature has shown over and over, that an acute radiculopathy with non-significant neurology. Now, that's where the difference lies. And a neurosurgeon may interpret a triceps weakness as a massive neurology and may actually tell the patient that if she doesn't have a surgical decompression, she may get into quadriplegia. And very often you see that in practice. They are quite aggressive. The neurosurgeon friends are quite aggressive on these conditions. But most of us and our literature backs conservative treatment. And what is this conservative treatment? Actually nothing. Just wait and watch. There's no evidence for medicines. There's no evidence for traction. There's no evidence for rest. So all you do is, wait it out. And in this time, use common sense. Don't try to do anything strange. The painkillers, I can tell you, can be a double-edged sword because your pain is holding you on guard. The pain is what's keeping you. It's like a thorn in your foot. If there's a thorn in your foot, you will step in a manner that the thorn doesn't hurt you. But if you have popped combiflams, you won't feel the pain and thorn will keep damaging you because pain, the guard has been let down. So there's as much as 90% success rate, and all these are options that we use. As far as rest is concerned, my personal tip is to give rest in a reclining position rather than a flat position. They often feel much better. NSAIDs, we discussed that. Gabapentin, again, is symptomatic, but you may or may not use it. Oral steroids, personally, I'm pretty much against giving oral steroids because once again, they're systemic medicines and a very small percentage actually reaches there. There is no evidence for or against it. There's some evidence for it, but I've had a patient, a friend of mine, an orthopedic surgeon, some of you all know him, who developed AVN of the hip with 3 days of oral steroids for cervical radiculopathy. Collar can again be double-edged. So whenever you give a collar, you tell them that if you wear the collar and the pain worsens, please stop wearing it because the size is pre-made. And if it causes slight extension, it can actually make your pain worse. So ensure that if you give a collar, tell them that you wear it, check if it's working, good. If it's not, chuck it. Or some people even advise a reverse collar where the Velcro side comes in the front and that eases off that extension. Traction, don't give because it's a hit and miss, and the 20% that will get worse will curse you for the rest of their life. We'll talk of epidural steroids. Dr. Raghu, if you're with us, can you unmute yourself and tell me your protocol on when would you use injectable steroids, topical injections in cervical disc, and which of the two do you follow?
So for me, actually now, after so many years, actually oral steroids have become lesser and lesser in my practice. And given a choice, I would actually prefer to give a local epidural against an oral steroids. I know a lot of orthopedic surgeons and even me in my early practice used to depend on oral steroids and they used to do wonders. Not that they don't, but I would prefer an epidural. The basic concept is that it stays local. It doesn't have systemic effects. For me, any pain which lasts more than 3 to 4 weeks is where I suggest an epidural steroids. I have suggested it to patients earlier. For example, I go to a trust hospital where there are people who do very heavy laborer work. For them, return back to work is very important. And if I have documented the radiological and clinical radiologically, I have offered them epidural steroids even earlier. But for me, a benchmark, if you say 3 weeks, is what I would look at.
Right, fantastic. So what we were trying to bring on the table is that epidural or topical steroids work much better. Unlike the lumbar spine, we are quite loath to giving selective nerve root injections. In Bombay, we've had a case where one of our most senior surgeons tried to do a selective nerve root injection under C-arm guidance, and the patient developed a pontine hemorrhage and was a vegetable after that. And so today, though in our practice, we do use selective nerve root injections if epidural have failed. We make sure that these are given under CT scan guidance. So we get a 3D analysis and we can actually see the blood vessels and we make sure that we are not mucking around with them. So the take-home message here is that most acute cervical discs will show great response clinically as well as radiologically. You have to reassure the patient, and the only indication for surgery is a patient who is impatient, who has no time and wants to get on with it. Moving one notch ahead, and Ranjit Unnikrishnan, if you can unmute your mic, because I'm going to ask you to join the discussion here, and maybe Dr. V.K. Sinha also, since I can see him. If you have a condition where you've bypassed all your conservative measures and nothing is improved, and this is a patient with this acute cervical radiculopathy, which of these options do you choose, Ranjit? The condition is, the clinical condition is acute cervical radiculopathy.
Only arm pain. Posterior disc, which is soft. Yeah. My choice is posterior cervical foraminotomy disc.
Fantastic. And Dr. Sinha?
I use surgery only less. And unless and until the neurological deficit is quite for some time, I do not go for surgery.
Sure.
And I do not use this epidural
steroids. Sure. Fantastic. Well, thank you for that.
I would like to add.
Yeah.
Hello. Yes. This cervical collar for myself also has worked nicely, and I am getting this cervical symptom that's about since 4 years, and I am cervical collar, and whenever I get this radicular symptoms, I apply cervical collar to myself and I get free within, say, you can say 1 day or 2 hours. So I will recommend a cervical collar that it should be made according to the person.
Great insight. Thank you for that experience, sir. And we hopefully will have a discussion on the use of collar in the Q&A session. But like Dr. Unnikrishnan pointedly pointed out, that most of us for an acute cervical radiculopathy with no myelopathic symptoms, soft new disc like we saw in that patient, our choice seems to be a posterolateral discectomy. Like this patient is a classical example. You can see on the MRI, it's a soft disc. It's a disc that's right in the corner. It's not at all myelopathic. So all you have to do is go from the back, drill this, laminofacet junction. And with this kind of a surgery, you can get an excellent result. You have to pick your cases well. The big advantage of doing this is you're not messing around with normal anatomy. It's a relatively, less invasive procedure. If you start doing big incisions and retracting a lot of muscle, you're probably leaving the patient more disabled than you would do with a standard ACDF. You're not messed with the disc, and the patient literally is pain-free in a very, very short time. Just a few tips on this posterolateral discectomy. Remember to identify the spinolaminar junction there, and you got to drill over there. You got to have a drill with you, because that's the only thing that actually leads you there. Remember that you got to work in the axilla of the nerve root, not the shoulder, as surgeons are used to working on the lumbar shoulder disc. But here, because the nerve roots are more flat, more perpendicular, not falling down, you end up being in the axilla, and hence there is some blood loss, which seems a lot because you use magnification. Try to avoid doing this surgery without any magnification. It's a poor choice. Preoperatively, your selection is poor, and I'm going to show you a case where this was a problem. So just moving forward, where do you choose ACDF versus ACDR? So you rather do the advantage of an anterior surgery for a cervical disc disease is that it addresses the pathology before visualizing the nerve. So you're not There's no temptation of retracting neural elements. It addresses the source. So, narahega bas, nabajega basuri. You have a degenerated disc which has prolapsed. You've taken away the whole problem. It potentially restores sagittal balance. On the flip side, the downside of an anterior surgery, it is physiologically more extensive. Though the incision is much smaller, there is no muscle dissection. You go through the normal planes. And potentially, it can cause adjacent segment decompression. The choices of anterior surgery for a radiculopathy are multiple. And we can choose any of these. In our local debate, we had all these questions put up. And at least a good 20% of our friends chose discectomy alone with no substitute. Most of the others go for discectomy with a cage with screws. Some of us do discectomy with bone graft alone. Some of us do discectomy with standalone cage. And some of us do the conventional plating. Many of us today have moved to artificial disc replacement. And we'll talk about that in just a moment because time is limited. So anterior surgery is time-tested, cheap, converts a painfully mobile segment to a painlessly rigid segment and disrupts the loading mechanisms, while artificial disc replacement is a more natural solution, but it's far more expensive. So when do you choose between an artificial disc replacement versus a standard ECDF? So you would err towards fusion when there are more levels involved, when there is more instability in terms of neck pain or translational mobility on dynamic x-rays, when the disc in question is the upper or the lower end of the cervical spine, where mobility is not a big deal anyway. In older persons, stable, more central disc, adjacent level already. No good word on which one is better than the other, but the very recent meta-analysis are suggesting that ACDR is slightly better than ACDF, though the follow-up is much less because it's a much younger procedure. The worldwide follow-up is about 20 years, our follow-up is about 12 years, and we are more than happy. At the worst, the disc stops moving and hence it converts itself to an expensive cage, but it doesn't do what a bad knee replacement does at the end of its tenure. It doesn't need to be re-replaced, which is the advantage. So if your patient can afford, today, this is the standard of care as far as my practice goes. If I have to do an anterior surgery for whatever reason, my choice would be an ACDR. So here's a standard patient with an acute disc prolapse, could not wait because time was running out for him. And the standard procedure for us, for him, would be an artificial disc replacement. Constrained, non-constrained, with keel, without keel, poly, metal. You know, you can choose what you like, but there are multiple options here. Now, here's a poignant case where as a surgeon, I chose to do a posterolateral discectomy because this was a young lady who had only radiculopathy. But what I missed out here is the black osteophyte that was sitting underneath the white disc. And hence, though she got good initial result of hand pain, she came back within a few months with significant arm pain again because the osteophyte could not be taken down from the back. And eventually, she had to be converted to an anterior surgery, just to make a point. Here's another case which can skew your plan. Once again, this is a young lady whose MRI doesn't seem so bad, but her symptoms were extremely compelling. She'd undergone a year plus of conservative trial. Her job involved bending over a draft board. She lives in Dubai and making drawings. And every time her neck bent forward, her hand would go to sleep. And if you see on bending x-rays, there's a translational instability, in which case she becomes a bad case, though she's a young lady, a bad case for an ACDR. She needs an ACDF and that's what she gets. And with that, she has a great result. We have a long-term follow-up on her. So you may know this guy. He's our Asian Games silver medalist. He came with the chief complaint of, he's actually from your state, if I'm not mistaken. Chief complaint of inability to shoot because his index finger in that position of shooting would go numb because he had a C6 disc and he needed to be in this position several hundred times a day and hence he gets an ACDR and he did extremely well. On the other hand, this gentleman from Haryana who's represents India in the Asian Games in wrestling, his problem was that every time his opponent did a neck grip, his hands and legs would fall weak and he had a huge cervical disc. Obviously, he doesn't go into ACDR. He gets an ACDF because you don't want a guy with an artificial disc getting those grips from those muscular guys around him. Another slightly different story. Again, all of you know him. India's foremost batsman at one point. His complaint was every time he took a stance, his hand would feel radicular pain. Otherwise, he was totally fine. But again, he had to take that stance several hundred times in a day. And there was no disc. If you saw, there was no compression on the MRI. But his complaint was very specific. And when you do more detailed analysis, you can get to a diagnosis. These sportsmen don't complain just like that. And he had a facet effusion, an unstable facet on the same side of the patient. And all you needed was facet injections and rotation stabilization exercises. And he did well. So I've run out of time here, so I will not move to the myelopathy bit, and I'll just stop at the cervical radiculopathy bit, and we can use these situations where there is multiple level anterior disc with myelopathy in maybe in the discussion. So just to conclude, treatment of options for a cervical radiculopathy with a cervical disc are not surgeon or institute dependent, but they are lesion and patient dependent. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nene. It was an excellent presentation. So may I just call Dr. Gautam Prasad this presentation, subaxial cervical injury. In the meantime, Dr. Nene, there is a question from the audience to
yes.
you. Dr. Neeran Narayan Singh from Paras Hospital, Patna, he has asked one question that he has a patient with cervical radiculopathy and improved with gabapentin. But weakness is present 3/6. It persisted till 6 weeks. So now what should be the line of treatment?
So you got to gauge the patient and gauge the weakness. So if it's a very high demand patient, for example, if it's a housewife with a non-dominant triceps weakness, a housewife will not use a triceps very often because it's a pro-gravity muscle. I would let it pass. I would tell her that there's a weakness. I would tell her that as per documentation, she needs surgery, but I'm choosing not to do surgery. On the other hand, if it's a basketball player or a manual laborer whose right biceps is 3 or 4/5, that may be a disabling disabling neurology. So I would then at 6 weeks definitely push him to do a surgery. I think that's my stand here.
So, but suppose there's no need to hold it back. Like suppose 3-6 weeks has gone, so you should straight away go for surgery.
I would not totally agree with that because like a left triceps weakness would not force me to do surgery because my surgery can't guarantee neurological recovery, unfortunately. So, despite that, what am I going to achieve? Pain is less. I may not be able to give the patient what she wants.
Right. Thank you very much. So may I invite Dr. Gautam Prasad, and he'll be talking on subaxial cervical spine trauma. Dr. Gautam, please.
Yeah. So good afternoon, everyone. So whenever there is a high velocity trauma or a significant road accident or a patient who is unconscious, we should always try our best to rule out that there is any cervical injury or not. Because most of our times, there is a delayed or misdiagnosis of cervical injury. And this is because of there is a failure to actually suspect such injury, or because the patient is unconscious, or we actually fail to do a whole spine screening MRI or a dedicated X-rays for cervical or CT for cervical. And up to 5% of the cervical injury, they have any spine injury, they have one or another injury in the vertebrae. So one should always have a high suspicion for injury in cervical spine, because this is very mobile area of the spine. And once there is a fracture injury which is suspected in a cervical spine, we should go in for a rigid cervical collar till we make an actual diagnosis as to what this injury is. And while transportation, we should see to it if we follow all the rules and all the rules to see to it that there is a proper log rolling, the head and the neck is well supported while the patient is being shifted, whether it is being shifted from the roadside site of accident to the hospital, or whether in the hospital the patient is moved for various investigation. So one has to take care that the neck movement is reduced to the minimum that is possible. We are aware of the clinical signs and symptoms, and all the dermatomes are well marked. So always do a thorough clinical examination to pinpoint clinically as to where we are suspecting the spinal injury level. And based on that, one should always proceed with the X-rays and MRI and CT scan if need be. In normal X-rays, we should check out all these lines and check out whether the alignment is maintained or not, the anterior, the posterior spinal line, the spinolaminar line, and the spinous process line. So if there is significant deviation or the angulation is increased, the differences, the space between the interspinous region, if that is increasing, that means there is some sort of instability and it warrants further investigation apart from X-ray, like an MR or CT. Now, what we see in an MR, we have to check out if there is a bony injury or if there is a disc herniation or if there is an injury occurring in the posterior part of the spine. Now, mind you, okay, this posterior element is the most important thing because it's the ligaments which means, act as a tension band phenomena. So those are very important vital signs and you should always look out for any sort of edema. That might be a subtle edema, but it might be indicative of posterior ligamentous complex injury, which is very vital, which can actually change our approach from maybe only anterior surgery to posterior or maybe a combined anterior-posterior surgery. Also, MRI gives us a chance to look at the cord, how bad the cord is damaged, whether there is any injury to the cord or not, any edema persisting, any pre-existing cervical myelopathy, which has worsened after the injury, that can be seen. And at protocol, most of the places, I think mostly 80% plus places, wherever the MRI of a particular part of the spine is being done, there is a rule to do a whole spine screen. So that virtually rules out any other missed injury, which we would have missed otherwise. Once we have gone through it, another important thing which for cervical MRI, we should look in the actual view, though I haven't put up the picture here, you should always look at the vertebral artery. The vertebral artery on both the side, whether they are equal, whether there is any intimal damage or whether there is any dissection of the vertebral artery. Because if that is so, then the whole prognosis changes. And many times there is an asymptomatic vertebral artery injury, which is associated most likely with a dislocation and in a fracture of the transverse process. And this at times can lead to your posterior cerebral artery infarct, PICA syndrome. Can be very disastrous. So always rule out, because if it's going to happen, we don't want our knife to be touched to the patient before that happens, because that then the whole blame comes to the surgeon. So that has to be taken in mind. There are various classifications, the Allen-Ferguson classification, in which the flexion compression, vertical compression, flexion distraction, similarly in extension compression, distraction, and the lateral flexion, they are mentioned. But this is not very very well, inter-observer reliability is not as good. And that's when the AO class, team came up with this classification. Basically, it's based on the morphology of the injury, whether there is any facetal injury, what is the neurological status, and some modifiers like a patient who has got osteoporosis or an ankylosing spine, or there is a vertebral artery injury. So in short, it tends to include most of the things which you want to look in. And if you follow this, it is less likely that we'll miss anything. Basically, they have first three main groups, that is A, B, and C, and then there are add-ons. The main A, B, C is like, C, first we have to rule out if there is a just like in thoracolumbar fracture, what we see, it's more because C means rotatory instability or a dislocation. B is the tension band failure, and A is the anterior body fracture. There are various subgroups which are given, and because of short time, I'll just go through it quickly. And there are various modifications, modifiers like a neurology and the modifiers otherwise. In neurology, whether it is an intact or a transient injury, or it is root injury, complete cord injury, or incomplete cord injury, accordingly, there is a nomenclature which is used, and that helps in actually telling us where, like a reciprocating your friend or your colleagues as to what particular injury it is. So once we see the X-ray and the MR, we have to first rule out that there is no translation injury. If it is there, then there is C-type. Once you rule out that, it can be either A or B. Then check out if there is a tension band injury. If it's A, check out. If the anterior thing is involved, then it is B3. All these things are there. But we'll just move on with the classification, because next, that's more important, which is a sleek classification. Subaxial injury classification. In this, the it is a first, it is one of the classification which gives importance to the neurological status. It gives us a score, and that helps in deciding the management of the patient. It gives importance to the three main criteria, which are the morphology, disco ligamentous injury, and neurological status. Whether in morphology, whether there is abnormality or not. If there is abnormality, whether it is a compression, burst, distraction, or rotation. As the severity increases, the grading increases, the score increases. Similarly, the disco ligamentous injury, whether it is intact, intermediately damaged, or totally disrupted. And neurological status, whether it is intact, a root level injury, complete injury, incomplete injury, or if there is a continuous compression in a setting of already compressed spine, weakness spine. So based on the scoring, if it is less than 3, then you might avoid a surgery, unless, as Abhay sir said, the patient wants a quick return to work and activity. If it is more than 5, then definitely you have to opt for a surgical intervention. So once we decide that, then there are various controversial things as to what is to be done. So there can be a medical management, conservative management, and surgical management. Again, this is debatable whether the steroid is to be given or not. It was there for a couple of decades, and then white paper came out whether the steroid actually does more harm to the patient than doing any benefit. And it's actually debatable. I have stopped using the steroid in this recommended dose. Pull of traction. Now, traction is useful to relieve the pain and it can be a helpful serial traction when we are trying to achieve a close reduction. But otherwise, if there is a fracture associated fracture in the skull, or there is occipital atlanto dislocation, or there is severe instability, global instability, these are the cases in which a traction, cervical traction, is to be avoided. So, when can we conserve injury? Cervical injury. If it's a stable fracture or a stable compression fracture, there is an undisplaced fracture of the lamina or the lateral masses, which is not causing any instability, or even in a facetal dislocation, which we can get reduced, a unifacetal dislocation, which we can get reduced by a close reduction technique. These patients can be given a brace, a cervical brace, a collar, and can be we can have a serial follow-up to check out whether the reduction is maintained or not. If it's maintained, just continue with it. But as and when you see that there is increase in instability, the reduction is slipped, going for surgical management. Now, the goal of the surgery in any case is to establish a balance and a stable spine with minimal motion segment fused, so that the patient is able to return to the full activity as soon as possible. Is maximization of the neurological functions and minimization of the cost impact. Now, once we decide the surgery part, when to do it. Suppose there is a progressive weakness, do it as an emergency. If there is complete spinal cord injury or a static incomplete injury, you have to do it urgently. That means you check out the best scenario that's possible for your setup and then go in for surgery. And if the neurological normal patient, but the patient comes with an unstable spine, then at the first instant that is possible for the patient and for us, we should go in for a surgery. Now, coming to some specific parts, the main groups will be discussed. Now, suppose there is a burst fracture. So obviously the morphology is altered and there is a neurological accompanying this. So these are the patients who will need a surgery. And because the pathology is all anteriorly, the burst fracture that warrants the anterior surgery, especially if the patient is having osteoporotic bones, like ankylospine or a patient elderly age group, then many times this anterior surgery has to be complemented with a posterior stabilization also. Otherwise, in a young chap, only the anterior will suffice. Coming to the most common scenario that we usually see is the facetal subluxation. So in subluxation, again, we have to go back to the MRI, check out if there is anterior disc herniation or not. Suppose there is an anterior disc herniation, then we have to go in for anteriorly. It's not that the disc herniation while reducing will always get more herniated and cause neurodeficit. There are just a couple of papers which documents that, but in case, there's a disc herniation which increases while we reduce if we go posteriorly alone, and the patient lands up in weakness, that will be a big loss to us career-wise as well as to the patient. So safe would be to go in anteriorly, do a proper fixation, and if there is an incomplete reduction or the reduction can't be achieved, then only in these cases one can go anterior and then posterior. Now in cases in which there is a disc disruption but there is no herniation, then these are the cases in which we can do only posterior job. But mind you, if the disc disruption is too significant, then there is always a chance of having a segmental kyphosis eventually. So we have to have a follow-up on these cases. And in patients who come with extension destruction type of injury, these are the cases in which we have to go for an anterior plating. And the next slide is actually very busy. Now in this, when we come across a transitional injury kind of patients, then we have to consider, we can divide it into two parts, whether there is actually involvement of the anterior body. So suppose the body is involved, but only one end plate is involved along with the posterior ligamentous complex injury. These are the cases which we can manage only posteriorly. If in specific condition, that might warrant an anterior and posterior. But suppose the anterior body is totally smashed, there is a burst fracture, then if there is a burst fracture accompanied with the posterior ligamentous complex injury, these are the cases in which we need to do a total 360 degree fusion, anterior and posterior stabilization. Coming to the next, the other half. Suppose the translation injury without any anterior bony involvement. In this case, again, like the previous scenario which I mentioned, check out whether there is a disc in the canal or not. Suppose there is a disc in the canal, go anteriorly. If you are able to reduce it properly and all anteriorly, just anterior fixation, if it is good enough, if you get a good hold, anterior fixation alone will suffice. But suppose anteriorly, after doing a thorough discectomy and doing all the maneuver, it's not possible to have a good reduction, to have a reduction at first place, then we'll have to go in posteriorly and go for 360 degree approach. Now in cases in which there is no disc in the canal, there's only posterior subluxation, then this can be done only by posterior approach. And there are various papers which documents that even a lateral mass fixation for such cases after proper reduction and fusion, if you achieve a good fusion, it is as good as the anterior plating. And in addition to the anterior job, as compared to the to that, this gives additional rotational stability. So posterior lateral mass fixation also in such cases can be done. But suppose there is an anterior good amount of disruption, then it might be prudent to add on anterior posterior fixation, specifically in a osteoporotic bones. Now the approach we all are aware of it, the Southwick Robinson approach. And that's how we actually go in between the sternocleidomastoid and the medial strap muscles. And once we reach the bone, then there is a prevertebral fascia on the either side, the longus coli are there. That's the approach. Always remember that whenever you go in, you confirm the level. And there are two ways we can confirm. Either we can put in a needle directly into the disc that we suspect the injury is, or they put in a K wire or something in the bone. Now my experience is like if we are on the wrong side, if we are there with the disc and put the needle in the disc, then the normal disc will start degeneration. So always try to put in a needle or a thin K wire, 2 mm or 2.5 mm wire into the bone, and then check the X-rays. So this will help us to not only to determine the level, but also to prevent acceleration of the ASD in case we put the needle in the disc space at the wrong level. Avoid excess protraction of the esophagus, because a famous surgeon in Mumbai, who is teacher to most of us, even he had a problem with esophageal injury. So always ask your assistant to be very aware of what he's retracting, and at times let him loosen the traction on the medial structures. The common complications which are associated with cervical injury are the respiratory failures, prolonged ventilatory supports, UTI, skin breakdown, pressure sores, and DVT. And DVT is actually itself a controversial topic. But as far as I am considered in all the quadriplegic, I tend to give a low molecular weight heparin because that keeps at least safe as far as legal procedures are concerned. So my take home message will be to have a high suspicion for identification of injury. There's an urgent attention should be given to the airway and hemodynamic stabilization. Identify the type of injury, what the patient has, where is the pathology, anterior, posterior, combined, and accordingly, you tailor-made approach should be made for each and every patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Gautam, for such a nice, elaborate presentation. So now I'll invite Dr. V.K. Sinha with his presentation, and in the meantime, there are two questions to you, Gautam, that you have mentioned that plain X-ray and MRI should be done for the cervical injury cases. Do you feel any role of CT scan for these cases anywhere in the spinal trauma?
So whenever there is some suspicion about the facetal injury, I get a CT done. Also, if I suspect a vertebral artery injury, then and if MRI is not very clear, a CT angio helps. Especially if we are going for a atlanto-axial fixation, these are the cases in which a CT is a must. CT angio is a must. Along with it.
So
I will show some cases also for this when CT is actually very important. In hand, the case discussion could put up those.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'll invite our next speaker, Dr. V.K. Sinha, to present his case.
Thank you very much. So, dear friends, it's good to be on the web. Discussions, deliberations, debates, and techniques could be endless. Since 1991, when I started spine surgery, till date, there that still lingers, and most of the cases, whenever I would like to discuss those with some case illustrations. The questions are when not to operate and what could be the prognostic assumptions which you can communicate that you can assume and be prepared for that and how to correlate it with any kind of available objective investigation. Whether you are to stabilize each and every case either with case graph or combination. And Dr. Nene has very well pointed out that at times you could do nothing to stabilize, you can just leave it. This is Sambhu Sathat, 5 male, 1.5 months old, C4-5 trauma in the X-ray, and it is his MRI. Note the myelomalacic changes, the dense myelomalacic changes, and the extending from the C4 to C6. Whether to operate in such an old patient with such high grade of trauma or not, and what prognosis I am to tell to the patient when he says his staff of operation currently, that he insisted that you should do the operation, but still, what prognosis I should tell to the patient? These were the questions, and these are the often questions that crop up in the mind. So I warned him in the writing, there's no chance of neurological recovery. I operated, did C5 colpectomy, iliac crest bone graft with plate, and there was involuntary movement in 3 days of that prognostic graft, but surprisingly, there was rapid, unexpected recovery, I should say. And I started working with some assistance in 21 days. A little video. You see, it is the patient. And all four, it was very surprising for me. And perhaps I cannot say that this is the usual phenomenon, but this is what has happened. So the question is how much late and with how much radiological evidence you are ready to operate? And he developed a superior facial, I see. Treated conservatively, recovered, and after 2 years, he had again it has healed again. I do not know what next will come. The second case is about 28 years old male, and you can note the displacement of the vertebrae. And you see the type of injury in MRI, myelomalacia. And he was operated about 3 weeks post-operative. You can see the CT. And there was very little recovery, very little recovery. The third case is Jamuna, 70 years old male, 3 months old. He has got traumatic quadriparesis. And the reflexes were exaggerated, holding and lower limb disc. MRI cervical spine showed fracture with recesses at C6 and 7, bilateral lock facets, myelomalacia extending from C5 to C7. And he had some injury in the lumbar spine also, and there was compression fracture of L1, L2, perhaps pertaining to the same injury. And grade 1 recesses old. You can say at L5S, there are bilateral foramen stenosis. Now, the question is which pathology was to be blamed and why and what could be the prognosis? So, of course, because there was, I guess, to do this for 57, iliac stress graft and plating, and he recovered somewhat and started walking with walker. Another case is Neeraj, 16 years old man. The injury is C5-6. C5 corpus was done at Bulgar. Any complication foreseen? I never had any in my mind. But after 2 weeks, he complained of mild abdominal discomfort. He had passed stool. There was no guarding and rigidity. But he persisted with some abdominal discomfort. That also was not too much. There was no padding, there was no rigidity. But the X-ray, I suspected something bad, and so I did the X-ray in sitting position, and there was gas on the diaphragm. There was intestinal perforation, and he was operated, recovered, neurological recovery was good. The point here to make is that if there is any abdominal symptom, if there is any symptom lower down, it may be modified because of the cervical cord injury. And you have to still suspect that there could be something like this. Without abdominal rigidity or the abdominal symptoms, that there could be perforation like this. Fifth case is Chandu Yadav, C4-5 case. It's not trauma, but I have put it purposefully to say only one point, that whether is implant necessary in every case. So the compression was done, and this bone graft from iliac crest was done, and this was the case, and you can notice wonderful fusion and almost restoration of the spine. No implant, and good fusion achieved. Another patient, Ganesh Paswan, 35 years, 1 month old, fall of heavy object on his head. He had severe pain only, deformity in the cervical spine. There was the neurological deficit was doubtful. So it was, question was, what is the source of the pain and the deformity and what one is to do? And therefore, this MRI is like this. You can see not much damage, myelogram, and you see transverse section. No, not much of the neurological problem. So what could be the pain source, the deformity, and what could be the treatment plan? And so I did CT, and this was the deformity. And you can see in this CT that there was rudimentary C3 cervical vertebrae, and that was the cause of the deformity. And because of that trauma, it precipitated pain and all that, and he improved with only conservative treatment, no individual. So, 20 years old male, traumatic paraplegia. This again is not, of course, cervical spine, but I put it purpose to convey my some points which I have been introduced in the very beginning. So the T3 was in the problem. Should you operate? Because it was T3 and you could see the MRI. Should you operate? And what could be the purpose of the operation? The compression? Or neurological recovery or stabilization, because I feel and I have got working on the front body of it, that in T3, this area is quite stabilized with the ribs and all that. So you come, I mean, stability is not much of a question. And decompression at that higher, higher region. And with that type of cord, you can say transection, or you can say crushing of that cord, I don't think you expect recovery. So here he was operated somewhere with this extensive surgery case, bone graft, and stabilization by 8 discs. The outcome has been after expending about 14 lakhs. And he had come to me now with sacral sore, trochanteric sore, with recovery, and there is sore on the heel. So I think we should be very cautious about whenever we want to interfere. That the goal or the purpose of surgery must be very, very clear in our mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your different types of case presentation. I'll just invite once again Dr. Abhay Nene to prepare with his talk, and that is the fracture odontoid. This is the tense fracture. In the meantime, I'll ask a question to Dr. V.K. Sinha, that in the, one of his cases, he showed that in tuberculosis spine, he puts only ileal graft. So how can he ensure stability of the cervical spine?
Yes, rather in tuberculosis cases, in most of the cases I use only tricortical ileal graft. Of course, it takes a lot of carpentry, and you have to you make a very concave both the sides of the, you have to remove the end plates, and you have to make the vertebrae end plate, I mean the vertebrae adjacent vertebrae very concave, and accordingly you have to make the graft very convex and measure all the sides, its depth and length, and you should not distract too much and everything. So if this graft fits in very well in this in between the two concave surfaces of the vertebral body, and you can check this stability then and there, and it fits very well and it never disturbs.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. So may I invite Dr. Abhay Nene once again to present his talk on fracture odontoid, fracture tense.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir. I hope you can see the screen. I'm starting off this odontoid fracture, small brief, with a straightforward case of a guy who had a whiplash injury sitting on the front seat, the rear-ended somebody. And he came with neck pain to the ER, and the surgeon in the ER looked at his x-rays and thought they were normal. But he was slightly more initiated, so he asked for an open mouth x-ray, which also looked normal. So at this point, the surgeon discharged this patient from the casualty. And the patient went home, and his pain continued. And he went to another center where a slightly more initiated surgeon did a proper open mouth view. And he actually found that the primary clearing agent had actually completely missed an odontoid fracture. So odontoid fracture can slip in from nowhere. And I'm just going to talk to you about odontoid fractures, who to fix, why to fix, and how to fix. So just moving on. Remember, for odontoid fractures, open mouth views are a part of all screening images. So when you get a patient with neck pain in the casualty with a history of trauma, don't miss out doing an open mouth view. And in that open mouth view, you've got to visualize what you want to see. And even then, the x-ray is not reliable, as you saw in the last case. So do CT scan as much as possible. And in many Western countries, a CT of the brain with screening of the spine is a standard of care for clearing a cervical spine injury. No MRI, no x-rays. You come in and straight away go to the CT gantry, get a CT, brain, C-spine. The hit-miss ratio, the effort-benefit ratio is far more favorable in a CT rather than multiple x-rays for trauma in the spine and the brain. Dynamic x-rays, avoid doing, because the instability could be much more than you thought about, and you can actually precipitate a neurology. The next question is MRI or CT scan. And if you see the MRI, some of us can visualize that white line there, but many of us can miss it. So the point I'm making is that MRI is not a great investigation for the occiput C1, C2 region, because there are too many artifacts there. And a CT can define that same injury so much better that you want to err on a CT. If you had a choice to do one, I would say CT scan if you're suspecting an upper cervical injury. Now, who to fix? So the two considerations are look at other injuries and look at his general condition, the Glasgow Coma Scale, because many of them have associated head injuries, and look at the type of the odontoid fracture. So to quickly move on to what are the types of odontoid fractures, there are three types. Type 1, which is an avulsion fracture of the tip of the odontoid. Type 2, which is a fracture that goes through the waist of the odontoid. And type 3, which a fracture which goes through the base of the odontoid. This classification described in 1974, 2 years after I was born, is still in vogue, and we still work this classification because it kind of puts everything into perspective as far as treatment is concerned. Before moving forward, all spine surgeons know that in the C1, C2, occiput C1, C2 area, the crown is worn by the ligaments. The ligaments are king, and the entire classification of treatment would depend on what's happening to the ligaments, as you will see in the ensuing slides. So a type 1 injury is invariably an avulsion injury where the apical ligament has actually pulled off a chunk of the odontoid. And this usually is a stable injury or a very unstable injury where you have an occiput cervical dislocation, which is an OC1 injury where mostly the chances of survival are less than 10%. So this injury, if not associated with OC, you got to keep your eyes open for OC dislocation. Look at ligamentous disruption on MRI scans in the in the occiput cervical joint, OC1 joint. And if that is not there, it may be safe to treat them just with immobilization, and they don't need any intervention. The type 2 odontoid fracture is the one that's the bugbear of our practice, because the type 2 odontoid fracture, as you can see, is a guillotine amputation of the odontoid by the transverse ligament. The transverse ligament takes the odontoid down with it. And because it happens in the waist of the odontoid, when you see the odontoid, it looks like a 9-pin of bowling. When you go bowling, the shape of the 9-pin is what the odontoid looks like. So the narrowest region, which is the waist of the odontoid, is where this fracture happens. And it's a cortical bone fracture. It invariably is because of a high velocity trauma, and it's usually displaced, and hence there's a high chance of non-union, pretty much like the transcervical fracture of the hip. And hence, very recently, Grauer actually reclassified this because it's an important fracture. It is the one that actually surgeons are called in for. He divided it into three categories, and we'll go through them. The type 3, which is again a low-intensity fracture which happens in the cancellous base of the odontoid, is surprisingly one of the commonest bone injuries in the neck that will happen in an osteoporotic elderly person. So if a person who's over 70 has stumbled in the house and fallen and his neck hurts, there's a high chance he's just smashed himself through the base of the odontoid. And once again, all you need to do is immobilize and give anti-osteoporotic treatment, and that's all you need to do for these fractures. So coming back to the type 2 fractures, why do you have to fix? There are two real reasons why a surgeon needs to fix. One is instability, which can lead to neural compromise, as you can see in these images, or non-union, which comes much later, where you come with chronic pain and a threat to the neurology. In both these conditions, you're called on to fix. Now, how do you fix this fracture? So typically, you got to look at the type of fracture, the stability and the reducibility, and then ask yourself, do you want to fix the odontoid or fix C1, C2? So direct fixation or indirect fixation. So type 1, 3, we leave aside because they are usually non-surgical. Coming to type 2, see if it's a reducible odontoid. If it's a reducible odontoid, you can just fix it in place, and that's your surgery. But you got to document reduction, and unfortunately, often X-rays are not good enough to document a good reduction, and you need an extension CT scan to make sure that this is setting in. In an acute fracture setting, sometimes difficult to get that extension CT scan. So in a chronic setting, it's quite easy. A non-union scenario, you do an extension CT, get a SAG image, and decide whether you can pass a screw. In an acute setting, you have to take a call based on the CT that is available. Fortunately, acute fractures are often reducible because it's been displaced for a very short time. On the other hand, if it's an irreducible odontoid where the transverse ligament is actually getting in the way of reduction, you will have to do a posterior operation and do an indirect fixation, fix the C1 to C2 and forget about the odontoid. It's a more disabling surgery. Talking of the odontoid screw, where we will allude to the subtypes of type 2 fracture, obviously, an odontoid screw is a far better, more natural, a more correct method of treating an odontoid fracture. However, there are many limitations to when you can do this. The fracture line has to be favorable, and here is those three subtypes of fracture type 2. The subtype A is a transverse fracture, which is, as an orthopedic mind will see, all of you in the audience, your eyes will see that this, if you pass a screw here, the screw has to be fairly oblique to be able to, you know, correctly go across the fracture line and not skive from the fracture line. This is a very favorable type 2B is a very favorable fracture line where it is oblique from the front top to the back bottom. And here the screw with a less angulation will still transversely go across the fracture and give a good compression fit the lag screw. And this is a very non-friendly fracture line where you cannot get a screw into this fracture. So type 2C, where the obliquity is back up to front down, the screw will just skive off and it's a waste of time trying to do a fracture fixation here. You'd have to do an indirect surgery here. Of course, comminution has to be less. The fracture should be reducible. And the patient's body habitus, people with bull necks, short necks, big chins, they are not amenable to this surgery, as you will see in the ensuing slides. The advantage, of course, is that you retain the C1, C2 mobility. You're doing an internal osteosynthesis. You're not fixing a joint to fix a fracture, right? So what is the technique? A few technical tips. The neck has to be kept in slight extension to reduce as well as to give the surgeon space. The mouth has to be kept open because you need AP shots all the time. So we normally keep a ball of gauze or a cork in the mouth. So that's how the mouth stays despite the tube. You need biplanar fluoroscopy, though in our setting, we usually use one C-arm AP lateral, but ideally you should have a bipolar, two C-arms available. Now, this is the thing, that the angle that you're going to get at is such a low angle to get into the, to get into the odontoid, in the angle of the odontoid, that the incision comes very low in the neck. And for this, the neck has to be long. And if the neck is short, your incision does not allow you to get that angle. And that becomes a problem. This you have to visualize when you actually put the patient in, the entry of your odontoid screw, remember, is at the in the disc space between the C2 and C3 most of the times. You have to go so low, get under and get that angle. If you get your entry point from here, for example, you will never get the angle that you need. Here, the angle will go that way and you will skive again the fracture. Make sure that your placement on AP is also midline. So this is largely a fluoroscopy guided procedure. It's pretty much similar to fixation of a transcervical fracture of the hip. In the days of fracture fixation, we would do this, through a small incision and mainly through fluoroscopic guidance. There is a technical tip that as you pass, just like the transcervical fracture of the hip, as you pass your screw, the screw pushes the distal fragment away. And hence it's important for you to tap the distal fragment. So the screw actually latches on and the lag screw actually pulls the fragment close rather than pushing it away. Very often your tap pushes the fragment away. And in such situations, sometimes the surgeon has to put in a finger through the mouth and stabilize the fragment and then pass the tap to make sure that you're through. Sometimes an additional K-wire can help, a K-wire to hold on while you're passing the screw. And that can help, putting a screw without the fracture displacing. Two screws are better than one, but they are virtually impossible. Personally, I've never had a odontoid big enough to accept two screws. So mostly, if you're worried about the rotational stability, so as you pass the screw, if it's a single screw, you can actually rotate the distal fragment. It's sometimes a good idea to pass a stabilization K-wire and then pass your screw and then remove the K-wire. There is space for a K-wire. There's no space for two screws. Remember to countersink the screw head, because as time goes, the screw pulls back as the fracture unites and the head becomes slightly more prominent. And this is how that fracture will be fixed in a classic type 2 odontoid fracture. However, the set traps are these. These are cases from the internet. They are not, fortunately, I've not had, because I do very few of these surgeries. I often end up doing the posterior surgery. So if your angle is incorrect, angle of the fracture, you may skive, as you can see here, and the reduction or the fixation is not good enough. And here, if it's a very porotic fracture, you may shatter the fragment. And again, it's a waste of time. Quickly moving on to C1, C2 fixation, you can do it with wires. So if your fracture geometry or the patient analysis is not favorable for an odontoid screw, you do a posterior surgery. A very simplistic approach, again popularized by our teacher, Dr. Bhojraj. Just simple sublaminar wiring with a bone graft, described more than 60 years ago. the modern approach is a transarticular screw where you pass a power screw. This is much easier than you think it is because it's all done under vision. You actually dissect and visualize that joint and pass your screw. The problem is that, again, the trajectory of the screw has to be extremely flat and your incision has to be much longer. So this becomes an easier procedure where we pass a screw through C2, the entry point being under the the arch of C2. Again, it's much easier than you think it is because most of your bag structures are pretty far away and you're starting far and then going farther away. So again, it's a pretty simple, straightforward procedure done under vision, and I'd encourage all of you to learn this on cadavers, and it becomes a very easy procedure, especially for cases like these where reduction has to be done manually. Intraoperatively, to pass a C1 screw, use it for reduction, and then like a spondylolisthesis surgery. So my take-home message would be that do a CT scan for a odontoid fracture. Red flag the type 2 fracture, which is displaced, reverse oblique, or comminuted. And wherever possible, odontoid screw is your first choice, and when not, C1, C2 fixation for the rest. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Nene, for your presentation. It is a very difficult fracture. So one question to you, that when you do transarticular C1, C2 screw fixation, and if the fracture is posterior, so how you assess the instability, whether the C1 is involved or not? Even after putting the screw, the fracture can be unstable. So how you assess that?
So transverse ligament instability has to be seen, and that's quite simple. If you see the C1 ring dislocating from the odontoid, that means the transverse ligament is not intact. So typically in an odontoid fracture with an intact transverse ligament, you will see the odontoid moving ahead with the C1 ring. So the gap between the odontoid and the C1 ring is not there. The whole segment has moved forward. I think that's the... but typically in an odontoid fracture, the transverse process is intact. So C1 is not unstable, because the reason why the odontoid cracked was that the transverse ligament cracked it. It pushed it.
They say that every posterior dense fracture, type 2, there is almost always associated C1 ring fracture. Is it true?
Not true, sir. And even if there is a C1 ring fracture, you can pass screws through C1 lateral mass. But if you're at 6s and 7s, you don't miss a lot by doing an occiput cervical fixation, because the only movement you miss is this nodding movement. So maybe 20-30% movement is further lost. So then just go the whole hog and do a occiput to C2 fixation.
So do you feel to add posterior fixation as well with the ring? With the wires?
Sir, if a ring is fractured, you can't fix the C1, C2 with wires. The actual, my co-faculty can give the inputs, but I've rarely seen odontoid with C1 ring fractures. It's not Jefferson with odontoid is not a commonplace scenario. But if it is, then I would rather go the whole hog on day one. Go and do an occipital cervical fixation. Forget about the odontoid, forget about the ring, forget about the wire.
What is your personal view? The learning curve is very high?
Not at all, sir. Not at all. It's more in the mind. If you just sit on a cadaver, you will see these screws are passed directly under vision. So you see the bone, you feel the bone, and you pass the screw. So it's more of a cough in our mind that, bhaiya, wahan pe toh sikhaya nahi hai during MS. But you just sit on a cadaver and do one or two times, and it's all under vision. I was not trained in this in my training, and I just learned it on my own.
To avoid injury to the vertebral artery?
So that's the thing, that the vertebral artery is lateral. You start medial to the vertebral artery and go further medial. So you're starting away from your enemy and going further away. So the chance of actually injuring the vertebral artery is very low, unless your dissection is poor. I think you have to drop your orthopedic hat and use your general surgery or neurosurgeon hat when you do dissection at this place. You can't just use a cautery and start buzzing. The dissection has to be a soft tissue dissection using scissors, using dissectors rather than cautery. If you take care of that, there are some set traps where you don't fall into and you're fine.
Yeah, Dr. Samsudha wants to ask something.
Yes, sir. Dr. Nene, I have a question for you. Do you always do pre-op CT angio for all C1 CT fixation?
I'm guilty of not doing CT angios in all cases, but I think the correct advice is to do a CT angio for all cases.
Okay, my second question.
Maybe can.
Yeah. One more question, sir. How to proceed if there is a vertebral artery anomaly?
So anomalies can be of various types, but if there is an anomaly which comes in the way, like a high riding vertebral artery, you can always find your way around it. For example, if it's a high arch with a high riding vertebral artery, you can use a shorter screw, which doesn't, you know, reach that vertebral artery on one side. And or you can consider, you know, using one-sided screw and one-sided wire, or you can actually use a translaminar screw and a, you know, screw rod insert on that side. So again, more is spoken about it. It's good to know beforehand, but it will not stop you from your surgery.
Even a pass screw can be good in this case.
Yes, sir. Pass screw, a short pass screw, but not a long pass screw.
Yeah. And how to conserve type 3 odontoid fracture?
So we normally just give them a fill collar and give them anti-osteoporotic treatment, and within 2-3 months they just heal off. So we give teriparatide basically.
So one point here, if I can.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
So one point here, I think in the type 1, one of the things that you can miss actually is the os odontoidium. It's a known thing which can be a differential diagnosis. And I've had recently one. They thought it was a type 1 injury, but it is an os odontoidium. The second is, I think, like Abhay said, the myth for the orthopedic group is because we don't do it so much during residency, we believe that the OC1, C2 area is a dangerous area to tread in. I think three principles that expose well. If you see most people who do it, you see to it that the soft tissue dissection is so apt and meticulous, you might spend more time actually doing it than the putting in the screws. The two is actually knowing your anatomical landmarks very clear. These are ones in which you don't even need the C-arm in some case, if I might make that statement. So anatomical in nature that you know that where you go would not tread into wrong areas. I think that's most important.
So thank you very much. It was a nice presentation. Now the discussion is there. So I'll just request all the speakers to be ready. Dr. Abhay Nene, Dr. Gautam Prasad and Dr. B.K. Sinha. So the first question from our audience, Dr. Abhishek from Darbhanga, and he has conveyed the regards to Dr. Abhay Nene, and he has asked the question that a case of cervical myelopathy with MJOA score 8, what promise can we make to such patient in counseling? His question to Dr. Abhay Nene and Raghu sir both.
So maybe Raghu, you want to go first?
Yeah, so I think this is... You can see Abhishek is getting senior in the business. So, you know, these questions normally come only when you get senior. I think myelopathy is a very tricky zone because there are times that you've done a wonderful decompression. You did a perfectly good job. Your MR sometimes looks worse post-op than it was pre-op. And the neurology is not well reflected in recovery. So I think promising something might be actually not the right way forward. The counseling should aim at somewhere telling the patient that you're doing it for more for prevention of worsening of the problem, which might be more difficult to retrieve with time, rather than give them a lot of guarantee about recovery, because the symptoms that they come for is so complex that you may not be able to solve all of them. I hope he gets the point. Abhay, you want to add?
No, I think you just hit the nail on the head. That you don't promise improvement, you do surgery to contain worsening. And as long as your surgery is well, you hope that things will get better.
So I think, Dr. Abhishek, are you happy with this? So the next question is to Dr. Gautam, that low molecular weight heparin in cervical spine trauma cases, is it advisable to give? And if yes, then how many days?
So the chances of DVT is much higher in the first 6 weeks. And it can happen up to 3 months. So what usually I do is, for the first 3 months, I give low molecular weight heparin at the dose of either 40 in a low underweight guy or 60 milligram in an adult. 60 milligram international units subcutaneous daily for the period of 3 months. Also, in all my spine cases, I have a habit of giving tranexamic acid. So all in this quadriplegic and paraplegic patients, I specifically avoid giving such intra-op tranexamic acid, and post-op I start with heparin at the earlier.
Thank you.
Your take on Dr. Raghu and Dr. Nene or Ranjit regarding this heparin?
Ranjit, I think you can go on this.
Yeah, yes, very much like what Dr. Gautam mentioned. You got a very high risk of DVTs. So they have pre-op itself, and generally all these cervical spine patients get, if not operated urgently for their mentioned indications, they take time to be medically stabilized before surgery. At that point of time, LMW, heparin, along with calf pump is standard protocol for us. And also post-op, till they sit up and their rehab sets in, they are like, I continue typically for 3 weeks. By the time they are really made to sit up with some support, etc., and the bystander or the caretaker is instructed how to do limb mobilization intermittently, all these things help in decreasing VVD. And I use heparin, I use aspirin after that. So recommendation is to use LMW for first 3 weeks. Then I switch over to oral aspirin at 325 milligram, which is used by the arthroplast surgeons, which has got definite evidence and recommendation. I use oral lacosperin.
Anything you want to add, Dr. Nene?
No, I think I'm in agreement. I think Ranjit was much better to answer this.
So one more question is from Dr. Sakti Kishore. He's assistant professor in Nalanda Medical College, to Dr. Nene, about the fracture odontoid. That is there any other method for reducing displaced odontoid fractures closely besides slight extension of neck?
Finger reduction through the mouth under anesthesia can actually push it back. But you know, it's very hard to plan this because it has to be an intra-op. And once you decide, because ultimately, as a surgeon, you have to take a call. Am I going to go from the front or go from the back? So with an extension CT, if you don't see adequate reduction, most of us, pull the plug and go from the back. It's very rare that sometimes you get a reduction, but in the, you know, intra-op, there's no adequate reduction and you use this finger digital technique. I don't know for third technique, Ranjit, Raghu, Gautam.
That is standard.
Yeah. So we sometimes use an intact transverse ligament, and the C1 screws are used to pull back to get the odontoid back. But then that is, again, posterior surgery. It's not in an odontoid screw.
Yeah, even most of the, in my practice, most of the cases, odontoid are the ones which I go posteriorly C1, C2. You know, the cases
I agree, I think.
Which means the case, I mean, I'm yet to find a real case which alone you have to do anterior and you're fine. Most of the ones, if you see, when the odontoid fractures, there is significant amount of C1, C2 ligamentous injury. You cannot expect fix a very small, tiny bit of bone and expect the entire occiput to stabilize. So it makes more sense to go from the back and fix the C1, C2 joint so they heal well. It is like hoping to fix the fracture neck of femur with an acetabulum and hoping the acetabulum to stabilize. I don't think it happens. You have to fix the acetabulum, right? Same way.
So you don't prefer transarticular fixation?
Not many. I have not had much patients where the patients in which I can do a transarticular, they heal with conservative therapy also. Non-surgical measures also. And again, if the criteria where the fracture line has to be amenable for anterior fixation, there should be no osteoporosis. Those kind of, in my practice, I don't see much. So all 9 out of 10 is posterior C1, C2.
Right. Question to Dr. V.K. Sinha, that one of the dreaded complications of anterior spinal surgery, cervical spine, that is esophageal rupture. So, if it should not happen, which we should take care of that. But if at all it happens, then how should you manage? How should you manage?
I said you in my case, because having a bit of passing, so I mean, this rice tube. The first tube was already in, and when we diagnosed that there is some esophageal rupture, perhaps because the air bubble with some discharge was coming out. And then we had this variable swallow test, and it confirmed. And the treatment given was only just the rice tube feeding and conservation. And because there is very set tense to it, that whenever a tube is ruptured, you just bypass it some way, and the tube makes it separate.
Thank you very much. We have a little short of time. So we'll go for the case discussion. And I'll just ask Dr. Gautam and Dr. Raghu. So they will present their cases.
Hello. So this is a lady, 48-year-old, who came with a history of RTA some 3 months back. She had difficulty in neck movement and weakness in all the four limbs. So she was a walker, but she had some early signs of human signs and weakness in all the four limbs. Now, this is a X-ray and MR at 3 months of the injury at presentation. Can I ask all the panelists to opine? Dr. Ranjit?
Yeah, in this case, I definitely need CT scans, especially parasagittal cuts, because this looks like a locked facet, 3-4-5 locked facet flexion distraction injury with significant posterior ligamentous column injury, which with fairness would have been not so unstable or picked up at the day one, eventually went into kyphosis because of PLC injury. So now, she's 3 months post-injury, correct? 3 months post-injury. Am I correct, Gautam? Yeah. So we have to know. So now we know that she has got deficit. She has got pain. She is developing progressive paraparesis, means there's progressive neurology. With this picture, very likely she has got significant foramen stenosis at the 4-5 level. Now, the plan of treatment depends upon, number one, what is the status of the facets? Number two, is there any annular rupture or a fracture in the canal, which does not look like on the MRI? So I will definitely need a CT scans, parasagittal cuts, to know if the facet is fused or unfused. If the facet is not fused, I will, in these patients, still try a bit of traction in the ward and try to get them into extension. If they reduce, just do front and back. If it is locked facets, fused facet, do from the back.
So what will you do from back?
So if the CT scan is showing that there is no facetal healing or the facet is not it is not really fused out there, then generally I will open the facet, I'll do a facetectomy, it will reduce my C3-4 joint. And I'll do a single segment fixation, lateral mass or pedicle fixation of 3-4 and fuse it there.
Only posterior, you mean?
Only posterior in this case, if I'm going first.
Because here, we didn't get a CT, but the X-ray, the facet, there seems to be some mobility.
Yeah, facet looks fractured.
Could you appreciate? Yeah.
Yeah, so these things at times will get rigid there. No, or it might be really mobile. If it is really mobile, I will try to have it from the front. If it is really mobile, if it is not mobile, from the back.
Dr. Raghu.
So for me, this is clearly a bifacetal injury. There's no doubt because the amount of displacement, there is no rotation either. A bifacetal injury with fairly preserved neurology has to have a facet fracture. It's very unlikely that a jumped bilateral, you know, facet dislocation with no neurology, with a partial neurology. So I'm quite sure that I want to admit her, give her awake traction for a few days, and I'll get a significant realignment doing that. Then I would go posteriorly and drill the facets off anywhere they're of no use, get a good alignment from the back, fix her from the back, and then spin her around and do an ACDF.
So why you say anterior posterior and Ranjit is of the opinion only anterior?
No, it's about the disc injury. So for me, in a young whatever she is, I would want to add anterior column support to my posterior surgery. Though there's no evidence suggesting that if you do only a single column support, it will go into non-union. There's no evidence, but I'm happy because this is a half an hour, 45 minute surgery. You just go in, you are on the disc, put in bone graft and, you know, put a plate and get out. Maybe 1 hour. So I would complete the surgery and not leave it for a second chance.
Ranjit, when you say only posterior, are you not worried that later on there might be a segmental kyphosis at that level, which can lead to an implant loosening. Because as Dr. Abe said, anterior is, he would like to do anterior posterior both.
Yeah, in this case, I'm fairly confident of getting good purchase of my screws in the pedicles, or if not in the latmus also. And I'm fairly sure, because I won't have to do a laminectomy or anything out of this, I get a good amount of posterior master fuse it. And I will not, this patient generally, in if you look at evidence or like what Dr. Abe mentioned, nothing can be said that this is better over this. If you look at the European school of thought, they will always do 360 degree for this. But in my practice, which come in late like this, I'm fairly happy doing in the back. If it is really, really mobile, I go from the front, just do everything from the front itself. If they're not mobile, if it's fixed, if you have to go to from the back to drill the facet, release the facet, I'll do just back alone and it heals.
Yeah, so my question to both Ranjit Abhay and Gautam, in this is actually, will you decompress?
The decompression, yeah, if you can answer.
Decompress was posteriorly, you mean?
No, would you decompress at all this patient?
No, because if you get a reduction, that's a decompression. No.
That's the message we want to give it to the people who are the audience, that necessary quadriparesis, which we all believe needs decompression of the spine, may not be applicable here, because the reduction itself would probably lead to the decompression. Correct. So I think that's
basically it's more of a dynamic cause for the quadriparesis.
For me here, I think I'll go the posterior anterior, like Abhay said. I think I might not be so courageous enough to not be considered.
But I must add one approach here, which often Ram and these guys take, is a pure anterior approach, because it's a bifacial fracture. Sure. You just go in the front, get into the disc, reduce and fix, and that's one shot, you got the whole thing.
Is it okay for a very late case? You know, definitely good for a fresh case.
But 3 months, 3 months should not be so. For India, 3 months is like fresh.
So this is what was done, anterior and then posterior. Yeah, sure. And posterior, because of want of money, finances issue, only wiring was done for the interspinous wiring was done. And this is as 1 year follow-up. The facet has totally fused, and so has the anterior interbody fusion scene.
Can you open this, Gautam? Did you have a facetal fracture preoperatively, or was it just a perched facet? No fracture. No, what was
there was a there was a facet fracture.
So it was a mobile one.
So you put him on pre-operative action, no? Pre-operative action or whatever.
Well, in my scenario, I don't have the facility to keep the patient in hospital for 6 days, 7 days. That becomes too much of cost.
Okay.
Yeah. So coming to another case, is a 23-year-old male. He had a fall from bike under the influence of alcohol, and he had second neck pain, though he didn't have any weakness. Now, based on the X-ray, though.
How long since the injury? How long?
This is 3 days, 3 or 4 days. So here is the MRI, which doesn't show any significant compression.
Nil
as such.
Neuro, you said, na Gautam?
Nil neuro.
So Ranjit, if this one comes to you, would you do an MRI or a CTO? Say you have only choice of one.
Both. You mean between choice of both or only CT?
No. Yeah, only CT for this one?
Yeah, no deficit.
No deficit. Only a CT. Yeah.
For me, exactly ulta. If I had only one, I would do MR in this case, because there's no neurology. I want to see the PLC. And you know, if at all, I would see the cord and the PLC, because I may offer him non-surgical treatment.
Sure. So that's what I wanted to come in here. Gautam, you got an MR done first hand, or you got a CT and then an MR, or what was your
plan? This MR is there. I think we all, as a spine surgeon, need to be more keep our eyes open all the time.
Sure.
By mistake, I have marked something here, and that the X-ray that I have actually put in. Can you see this?
The hangman.
This is small arrow which I have marked.
Okay.
CT.
That's why I guess the CT here. For me, this one probably, I think.
Yes. CT. So this is a CT. Now you have the CT. Now, gentlemen, please open.
Okay.
My plan does not change. A hangman can very well be conserved. Just because as a hangman, it doesn't mean you can't conserve. Of course, when you conserve him, you have to give him the whole disclaimer about what may happen in the future. He may start getting kyphotic. You have to observe him. Conservative treatment means no treatment. It means very intensive follow-up. But I'm happy to conserve this, basically.
Ranjit, will you conserve this one?
There is a pincher kind of fracture of the C3 and fracture of the C2 posteriorly. So the posterior ligamentous complex is involved.
No, but
C3 can further collapse and lead to kyphosis. So down the line, 1 year down the line, you'll be more having a tricky situation.
Yeah. So if he doesn't have a lot of posterior tenderness clinically, and he's happy to wear a collar for a long time, I think the chance of this kyphosis hypothetically needing a surgery is very much there, which is why I said you give him the disclaimer. But if he's happy to go with it, I'm still okay to conserve this. Because think of what you're going to do. The surgery that you're going to do is going to be an enormous operation.
I think you're going to have to do back and front.
There's a fracture of both the sides. Both the sides, particularly at the base, has fractured. Yeah. And there's a fracture in the vertebral body, C3.
Okay, Gautam,
so independently, both will unite conservatively.
If you don't operate now, what will happen?
So with conservative, there is a chance that the patient can further have develop kyphosis.
It is very unlikely that he will develop neurology, because if the fracture and the injury did not cause neurology, over time it might not develop neurology, but he will develop kyphosis.
Correct.
If he developed kyphosis, what surgery would you do?
So then I will have to do a C3 corpectomy and C2 to C4 fusion.
Can you do it from the back that time? If he develop kyphosis, you can very well do the kyphosis surgery for the back.
So I am very skeptical as far as, because from posteriorly doing a PA, so I know very much people are doing
it. Patient develop kyphosis, which in the chances are very minimal, because with that nutcracker fracture is going to heal, because the PLC is not muchly damaged. It's going to heal with a bit of kyphosis, which I can, if it progresses, I can do from the back. Whereas if you go in right now, I will be doing a radical surgery. A C3 corpectomy, putting in C2 to C4 with a fractured C2. So I personally will agree with Abhay and Dr. Gu. I'll conserve this with all those disclaimers. And if he develops a kyphosis, I'll be happy to go from the back and correct it.
So Gautam, what did you do?
So Dr. Raghu, you are also of the opinion, conserve?
Yeah, what I'm trying to tell you is the disclaimer is the big problem. When you try to explain it to the patients, I'm not too sure how much the patients would stand up for you, say 6 months down the line or 8 months or 9 months down the line. So if you said that you offered surgery to him at this stage, I wouldn't say no to it at all. And for me, I think, I wouldn't point fingers at you for sure. But given a choice, scientifically looking at it, this is something you could still conserve and probably do it at a later stage, which you may not need to also. At one point of time. I think that's the point. So what did you do, Gautam?
There was a question next. I have opted for surgical management.
Sure. So
there was a question of going anterior, anterior, posterior, only posterior.
Okay.
So this is what I have done. I put in screw in the C2, C3 as well as C4. And anteriorly, I hope for the ligamentotaxis to work. And this, the extreme right side that you see is actually one year follow up.
Nice, yeah. Very good. I mean, done the job for him.
Basically, I want to maintain the motion at C1, C2, so I didn't go higher up. And because the C2, there was no significant combination, I thought of putting the pedicle screw right through.
That is the right way, Dr.
Nice.
That's the right way.
I think it's perfect. Perfect.
That's the way you should go it, yeah. Don't have to go.
Yeah, very
or
nice.
Or even C1 for the matter.
Yeah.
So my argument was that even if it happens late, I'll do the same surgery. For kyphosis, I'll do the same surgery.
Okay.
Next one, Gautam. We have one more.
So this.
Do we have time? Somebody keeping a watch on the time?
Yeah, we have 25 minutes more.
Oh, so good.
So this is a 80-year-old male who had a fall, and he came with quadriplegia. It's a known diabetic, known hypertensive, and with ankylosing spondylitis case. Can somebody check out the X-rays, or should I proceed with the MR?
Known case of AS.
Known case.
AS or
like dish? There is all this.
Because it's not like AS.
It doesn't look like AS. This one. It's more dish.
And the whole spine was actually fused, sir.
Okay. But even then, the classic difference between AS and dish is that AS doesn't have these cauliflowers coming out. Yeah. It has a railroad picture. Cauliflowers are seen in dish. But it, anyway, it's a semantic difference. Doesn't matter.
They behave the same.
So this is the MR of the same patient. Dr. V.K. Sinha, sir, would you like to opine as to how to proceed?
Yes, hello. So, when you are 80 years old, then a collagen is one that is hypertension. So, and his quadriplegic, no?
Yeah, sir, his quadriplegic.
So, I think there is clear indication that the anterior side is.
Sorry.
You revealed.
Yeah.
No, I told you that I will go for anterior.
Anterior. Huh? Dr. Ranjit?
Anterior surgery. 80 years old, angspond or dish. Because deficit is because two reasons. One is the ligament is
Laminectomy,
lateral mass.
Yeah, Dr. Raghu and Dr. Naine.
Quick and out. Whatever you want to do, I guess.
Stay. Yeah, here I think decompression has to be done from the back. So there's no option of doing a front alone. But I may keep an option of front also available to this. So just last week, we did exactly a similar case, which was completely reducible. And hence, we did it only from the front. Because the magnitude of surgery from the front, like Dr. Sinha said, is much smaller than the magnitude of surgery from the back. But it has to be completely reducible where you don't have to do decompression. Here, you can't get away without a laminectomy.
So, for an 80-year-old... with all this... you're comfortable with
anterior? Anterior is much faster to get out.
It's much faster, but you do more bone work. For me, take off all those osteophytes to reach
there. Yeah, you just drill the osteophytes and put a big flat plate because the screws can go anywhere. The whole thing is ankylosed, so the screws can go.
Liver arm, it's very difficult to do reduction intra-op. So if it's getting reduced, that's a good thing from for the anterior side. Anterior, if you go to for anterior. Correct. What I did was posterior, two above, two below, and lateral mass and a good decompression. The thing is, all these patients, they need prolonged ventilatory support, and many times some don't come out of it. So that's something for this 80-year-old. You all should keep in our mind, and a proper counseling of the entire family is a necessity in such cases. Should I proceed or some more cases from your end, Abhay and Dr. Raghu?
I don't have.
Raghu has that, probably. Raghu?
Sorry? Gautam is doing it for me. So I'm just kind of...
Go ahead.
So another patient with 50-year-old, three days fall, and again came with quadriplegia, doesn't have any comorbidity. Now, this guy has a disc anteriorly and posterior ligamentous complex injury posteriorly, which is Dr. Ranjit?
Yeah, so in this, we know that whatever has happened is because of the injury. My choice for this is to go from the back. Back. I'll reduce the fracture and do a from C5-6-D1-D2 junctional region. I'll do from the long segment back.
But you are not since the previous also you have the same thing, so you are worried about the disc anteriorly.
No.
The fusion anteriorly?
I'm going to do a good posterior fusion. I've got like enough. Follow up on this. You always don't need this anterior fixation. All these. The only time I would go is when I got a really sequestered fragment with an incomplete neurology, in which case I'll go from the front, remove the disc and go back and again come from the front. If not all this, I'll do from the back. This case definitely, because this case is going to have a bit of CSF leak. You can see the CSF leak in the second image. He's having dural tear. He has got dural laceration. You know, you can see here. No, this is the CS outside the column. I don't want to go and mess in all that. I'll do from the back. Abhay and Dr. Gautam. And
Same. Sinha. Long posterior, like two above, two below posterior. Because once you've come quadriplegic 0/5 power, there's a 2% chance that any recovery will happen, even if, you know, whatever surgery you do, back, surgery front, back also.
Surgery is immaterial.
Just go reduce, fix long and mobilize him.
One point here, I think, is these are the ones who are destined to have a very significant amount of ascending cord edema. They are the ones who really struggle to come out of the
ventilator
because of the amount of...
But it's pretty low, yeah. It's a 6.
The edema might go.
Look at the myelomalacia, it's gone all the way up, right up to C4.
So, and this image, you know, having the CSF in front of the vertebra means there's a significant dural tear. Yeah, there's CSF here. It's better not to go in the front in these patients. If they get infected, they get meningitis and they pop off. Anyway, these patients in the long term, you know that mortality after 1 year is 100%.
For me, a 6-7 is not as bad. I find it like an upper thoracic injury. A 4-5 could be, I would agree with both of you. But 6-7, I would just be quite bindas about it, kind of. Just go fix and mobilize and not worry about mortality.
On the long term.
Basically, stay behind. Stay posterior, whatever you want to do. Stay posterior. No anterior.
Piche se var.
Kya kiya tu, Gautam?
Front. I saw there's a long... And the maneuver is right here. So for me, this was as good as C6, not a C7.
Mm-hmm.
So I went anteriorly and this bit, and it was not difficult because it came up easily.
I thought I'd jump and
that was good. So I just managed with only long. There was a long. The time is. Sitting right, so it was almost the exact we usually encounter anteriorly, and just got away with the anterior because it was I could global instability or excuse osteoporotic fracture or this failure to achieve reduction by anterior alone procedure. Should we stop or we can continue or have a discussion on topics? The question which the audience are asking.
The few questions are there. So I'll just interrupt for a moment. So then you can continue, Gautam, again if the time permits. Then one question to Gautam, that how do you evaluate patients with ankylosing spondylitis conditions to prevent neurological deficit if not already present? It's a general question for AS, that if the patient is having AS, so how you counsel the patient or advise the patient to prevent neurological deficit if not already present.
Means the patient has got fracture and I'm going to operate and then counsel them for neuro deficit?
I think he asked if normal patient of AS to prevent any neurological deficit in his later life or something like that he has asked. He has not cleared that whether he wants to related to fracture or something.
So AS is basically you get ankylospine and those are actually osteoporotic bones. So any fall is detrital. So the basic thing one has to take care is to take steps to avoid falls. So your rooms, your bathrooms, you need to have places where you don't sleep.
And suppose he has a fall and there's no neurological deficit and you want to conserve the patient. How will you approach?
So, AS, if there is a fracture, there is always a chance because there is a long lever arm working. So, there is always a chance of going into non-union. So, such case, even if they present without any deficit, I would like to go in and fix a long fixation at that particular level. Right. What do you appoint, sir? Dr. Nene?
So, actually, the question is coming from, I think, from the fact that one of the senior ruling party politicians died he had a massive dish in the occipital cervical region.
Yeah.
And there was a small car bump from the back. He got cracked his C1, C2 and died. He got respiratory. He died on the spot, actually. So that's what you want to avoid. You want to definitely, because all other fractures can be managed, but a cervical, occipital cervical or a cervical whiplash can actually kill the patient. So I think you got to make them aware of that, that your neck is not supple enough to absorb that kind of an injury, which could happen just sitting on the back seat of a car and reading a newspaper. I think that's all I want to tell them.
Yeah, right. So Dr. Manoj Chaudhary, our BOA president, he's off for a moment, but he has asked that to Dr. Nene, that what is your preference, MRI or contrast CT for diagnosis of spinal stenosis?
So MRI, any day of the week MRI. For cervical spine stenosis, a contrast CT has got no value.
No value. Right.
So we can extend till another half an hour, sir. So by 15, we'll be finishing.
So, Gautam, if you have some case, you can present.
If there are more questions, burning questions, then I think that will be much better. If not, I will just show one or two cases more.
So, in the meantime, I'll ask a question, the question to Dr. Nene, that CT angio may not be required if you have a good radiologist to help with interpretation, but is the gold standard. Any experience with navigation for upper cervical instrumentation?
Actually, we have that CT guided navigation, but like I said, the cough is in your head, and these are instrumentations that are done under naked eye vision. So you actually really don't need navigation. I have used navigation in the cervical spine to remove an osteoid osteoma of the C5 pedicle, which was sitting on the top of the vertebral artery. So that's the one place where I've used navigation. But frankly, for upper cervical spine instrumentation, I think navigation is an overkill. And as a general rule, as a old timer, I may say that navigation should be an addition to your armamentarium. You cannot rely on navigation as your treatment. If you can't put a screw in C1, C2, you should not use a navigation. A monkey with a navigation is not a surgeon. A surgeon with a navigation can be a better surgeon.
Yeah. So what was your indication of removing osteoid osteoma on the pedicle?
Sir, intolerant pain, indolent pain, and the diagnosis was missed for over a year. And that's where a CT or a contrast CT actually score over an MRI scan, because the MRI, a small bright spot is missed. So actually, we found it out on a bone scan, a SPECT bone scan followed by a CT. You could actually identify that osteoid osteoma and then go in and remove it.
What was the
C5 pedicle. Yeah.
So we had one similar one. It was actually in the spinous process, which is not very common for that matter. He's a laborer. Used to do a lot of there are the Mathadi groups who are there in Mumbai who do a lot of laborer work. And for years together, he was treated for his neck pain. And like I said, we actually got a CT and eventually a bone scan and picked it out. The guy was mighty happy for such a prolonged period of chronic pain. Just knocking it off helps.
So one question to Dr. Raghu from Abhishek Sharaf, that what is your protocol in central cord syndrome in traumatic cervical spine?
So now the issue is basically, well, the first question these guys have is whether he's going to recover or not. I think most patients come to us with this is neurological recovery, which is their first question, as I understand. I think don't try to promise them. Intraoperatively, another thing which is very important if you're talking about surgery for them is that don't let them drop the pressures. The anesthetist shouldn't drop pressures too low. I mean, I tell my anesthetist that if you have a baseline pressure, let the systolic don't drop beyond 20 mm of what the baseline systolic was, because it's known, and I think Abhay and Ranjit probably will agree that Dr. Noordin had a paper which talked about how the commonest cause of intraoperative neurological worsening is actually poor blood pressure control. So I think don't let them drop the pressure. Sometimes we like bloodless feels, and try to be not over enthusiastic about it. I think that's something that you have to take care
of. Right.
So I want to quickly show you that osteoid osteoma. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, sure.
Since it's available, three slides.
Yeah, we'll have to see that.
This is how she presented, actually. And on the CT, you could see the clear-cut nidus. Now, the vertebral artery is very close, just separated by a thin cortex. So, and this was way back, you know, when I was Dr. Bhojraj's senior associate. I was not even a full-fledged consultant. I had to do this case. So, guess what I did? You know, I was not at all as Abhay as I am right now. So, I took her up in a CT scan. And at that time, we just started doing vertebroplasties, this is early 2000s. And under CT guidance with a core needle, we decored that osteoid osteoma. We got this out. Under anesthesia, we sterilized the CT gantry. We did the decoring surgery percutaneously in the CT scan. And that's the nidus that we got out. We sent it for histology. It confirmed that it's a nidus. Patient had pain relief. So we said that we have, you know, cracked a case. But only that she came back in a few months, the recurrence. It was incomplete excision of the nidus. And that's the recurrence of the osteoid osteoma, as you can see. And now there's no cortex even. So now you're really on gas to do anything here, because this is now saying hello to the vertebral artery. You can see there's no barrier between. So in this situation, you want to use navigation. And that's what we did. We used the navigation. You can see that's the CT navigation. We do an intra-lesional excision, but we actually have to expose the vertebral artery and take it out. So you can see how I'm gas here to remove that. But finally, that's the final picture of the excision. Thank you.
Oh, that is the post-op CT you have shown?
Yeah. Post-op CT,
right. So what is the take on this pedicle fixation?
Cervical pedicle fixation, actually. I think Ranjit can answer that better. He's been doing a lot of these, isn't it, Ranjit?
Yes. So to answer Gautam, number one, is pedicle fixation better than large mass fixation? Definitely yes, if possible, if can be done safely. Now, if you look at literature, there's enough biomechanical studies doing that lateral mass is as good as pedicle fixation. So if you're having, say, you have a lateral mass fracture or you have a tumor there, or your situations where you cannot put a lateral mass screw, it's fair enough to do a pedicle. If not, if you can learn it and do it, it's a good skill, not that difficult to do. And all these fracture spines which you saw, where there's total neurology, are real good patients for you to take time and learn your cervical pedicle fixations, so that when you have a degenerative myelopathy, where you have to put a safe pedicle, you are done with your skills.
So navigation will be of great help in such cases, right?
If you have it well and good. I don't have navigation. Like what Dr. Abhay mentioned, all my cervical pedicle screws are freehand, not under navigation. If you have navigation, yes, it's well, good enough. Navigation really works, helps you a lot in case of OC1, C2 congenital deformities, where you've got totally misshaped pedicles and bones plus vascular anomalies. That's where it really helps you. If you're having a lot of those in your practice, it's worthwhile having those. If not, all these degenerative cervical spines what we treat, all these regular traumatic cervical spines what we treat, fair enough to do cervical pedicles or lateral mass freehand.
I think the key to Ranjit's technique of freehand pedicle screws, you need a drill and you need a very small microcurate, because you don't do the standard path as you do in the lumbar spine. You'll just bust something. You have to make a hole in the entry point, which is quite lateral. Your angulation is quite lateral. And you keep decoring. It's like removing ice cream from a box of ice cream. And you keep decoring as you find the dabba. You know, the edge, you keep going down, and that you can't injure the vertebral. You may bust the pedicle, you don't rupture the vertebral.
Dr. Nene?
Sir?
Yes, sir. What are the complications you expect during this odontoid fixation, and how to prevent it?
I think it's a very good question, sir. The complications are all, all technical. It's because you've chosen the wrong case and the wrong indication, and hence completely getting convinced by a pre-op hookup that the anatomy of the fracture, the geometry of the fracture line is amenable to you, number one. Number two, the reducibility is convincing. And number three, the patient profile, osteoporosis and the length of the neck is good. I think these three are mandates before you consider doing an odontoid screw. And much like Dr. Ranjit told us right at the beginning, almost 60-70% of the times, these boxes don't get checked, and you end up pulling the plug and doing posterior. No headache, go and fix it.
If you don't have good vision, good open mouth AP, this is a disaster fixation. If you cannot get a good C-arm view of your open mouth AP.
Because even after all this is done, it's technically challenging because you need to get the wire across the fracture without displacing the fracture. So many of us, say, chhod do, fatafat peeche se karke nikal jao. Though it's a relatively a disservice to a patient. If you could have done an odontoid screw, but you've ended up doing a C1, C2, you've probably done an inferior operation.
Most times it starts even from your entry point. Most times you have to kind of rub against the C2-3 disc. A lot of your C2-3 disc itself gets knocked out the anterior part to get the right entry point to get the trajectory right, if you actually look at it. Secondly, most of the times your handle or whatever you use,
and fusion has any role for decompression by only laminectomy?
Actually, already trauma is a destabilizing injury. Adding laminectomy to it is further destabilizing. So rarely we have situations where a laminectomy has to be done standalone. It's criminal to do a laminectomy alone in a case of cervical trauma.
And with fusion?
Yeah.
One more question.
With posterior fusion?
Yes, sir. If you are you have the kind of cases which Dr. Gautam showed first, coming late presentation has got pre-existing dish or pre-existing cervical canal stenosis with a injury causing central cord syndrome, I would definitely do a lateral mass fixation along with the laminectomy. In which case, I use all the laminectomy bone as my fusion mass. I don't have to harvest any other, because in that case, I'm lordosing the canal, I'm expanding the canal, and I'm stabilizing the spine. So, all the three reasons.
Right.
One more question. That is rather query. This is, you are all doing cervical spinal trauma. So, have you ever encountered post-traumatic syringomyelia?
Post-operative?
Post-traumatic. Post-traumatic syringomyelia.
So it's very much usual. If you have these unreduced cervical kyphosis fracture dislocations not operated, if you keep them under long follow-up, they might develop syringes at the level of injury. They might develop syringes at the level of injury.
So I came across a case where the fracture was conserved of thoracic spine, D3 or D4, I don't remember. Totally on books, like whatever points we can conserve, all those things were present. Now 2 years down the line, he has presented to me with increasing weakness, and the cause was subarachnoid cyst, which developed because of some arachnoid injury. So I've sent it to the neurosurgeon, and even he could not. Like he had done the durotomy and all, but he could not find out from where the leak was. So finally, he had to put a stent in the second stage. It's not something which is commonly seen. So I just wanted to point out with this one.
Can I just light up this discussion with a very dramatic case?
Sure. Why not?
Sure.
May as well, since we are all hungry and sleepy, this will wake you up for sure. So this I hope you can see the screen. There's a young guy who had a cervical laminectomy done at a young age for Ewing sarcoma, and after that got progressive post-laminectomy kyphosis. We don't have records, we only have paper records. And a lot of things were done. In Bombay, there are some some surgical terrorists going around putting in cervical facet screws, cervical facet cages, spacers and let's not name these guys, but a lot of stuff was done. I just want to show you where he ended up with, and by the time at 2011 when he presented with us, to us, this is what he was like. Okay, so a lot was done and he was still normal neurology. You can see those spacers floating around because they did precious little. You see a very sad attempt at an anterior plate with no fusion, which is giving way. And at this point, you know, the options were, you know, very few. But my associate took over and he did an anterior palisade fibular grafting to stabilize him, which seemed like a sensible procedure. So this is a X-ray after the anterior surgery, removing the implants and putting in the fibula and fuse him in situ. Remember, he had no neurology. Unfortunately, after this, he kept worsening. And you see the fibula on the X-ray on the left has taken up very well, but the kyphosis has actually progressed. And then he presented 2 years after this surgery with a progressive myelopathy. And now he was going off his feet. So a young kid with an X-ray that looks like this, a solid C-shaped, uniform kyphotic cervical spine, this kind of a, you know, neural compression. At this point, I would like the opinion of the house. You know, how could you treat this? Ranjit, you're the obvious first sucker.
Send it to Ranjit.
So
I hope everyone sure understands the gravity of the situation. It's a fully fused C-shaped curve in the neck. It's not an angular curve where you could still think of a apical osteotomy, which is also risky and dangerous. And there's neural compression. So, yeah, so, and laminectomy is already done. So there's no role of any laminectomy.
So for this, my first thing is I'm not going to kind of do any correction here. My really worry is his deficit because of the internal gibbous. So I will go from the back, even though it looks, I'll go from the back, do lateral mass fixation, give a solid ground in the back from C1, from C2 to downwards, go up front, extended lateral approach, take off this internal gibbous.
The whole mass, like a 3-4 level copy.
The part which is from, I can say, from C2 lower, this part to this part. The internal gibbous.
C2 to here about.
This part.
That would be like a 3-level copic.
Don't attempt much. Whatever cord will fall back, will fall back. And I'll put a cage or from this part to this part with a plate here. But first is posterior surgery to keep my tension band long and then come from the front. And don't touch all these metalwork which is dying loose out there.
Gautam, that's a great approach, sir Ranjit. Congratulations, Aitya. Never thought of that.
What I want to ask Dr. Ranjit is, already posteriorly we can see good fusion. So why you want to actually instrument?
It's the same is if you funda, like after we see a fracture spine healed well, you remove the implant, the kyphosis progresses.
And here same you see way, Gautam, the kyphosis has that's the reason why he came back. He came back with progressive neurology. So I think Ranjit is on the ball.
This will progress. If that wonderful surgery done the first time where the fibula was put, that if it just a posterior fusion was done in situ, it would have been wonderful. It would have never progressed.
Raghu or Gautam?
So why not to just attempt at anteriorly a kind of a wedge restoration to probably C3, C4 level, what is now C3, C4, posterior fixation from C1 low down. With a posterior laminectomy.
Laminectomy is already done. Why laminectomy is done at the back?
Same thing was done at the post time, right?
Yeah. Even this portion of C2, which is remaining that. Like, I want to have a wedge kind of anterior wedge, open wedge kind of thing as C3, 4. Because low down, it's almost like what we could have expected.
So, you feel, Gautam, this is the apex. You just get, break this and then correct it here.
Correct it.
And get then, this kind of a shape in future. Well.
It will not correct. Just float the cord. Not expect correction.
You see, the apex of the compression is here.
Yeah. So this mass has to come out.
Or maybe multiple level open wedge kind of thing. Just do a... And posteriorly get a good fixation in correction. First do anteriorly, 2 or 3 level open wedge kind of thing. Fill it with cancellous and then posteriorly... Wedge? Get lateral mass and whatever correction is achieved. But frankly, Raghu, any bright ideas?
No, bright ideas. I think Ranjit made it look very easy, what he said.
So, luckily for us, the villain had left footprints. So, you have to, if you can follow the footprints of the villain had put cages in the facets. So, those were the footprints. And we could get in into the facets through, because we could identify metal. Where there was metal, you know you're safe. Yeah. So, if the villain has put his foot there, the ground underneath is stable. So, we followed that, took those cages off. And, drilled from there and went anterior to the cord from the back. And eventually did an internal gibectomy from the back. It's a very daring operation. You can see these successive pictures. You followed the cages like a T-lift kind of from the back, going into the facets, drilling out from the front, curating out upar niche, and doing my boss's favorite surgery, a TPD alone for a cervical spine. And we had our, our essentials in our mouth at that time. And somehow we just went across and we got a fairly good decompression. And this guy lived for another 5 years before he developed Ewing sarcoma of the thoracic spine, which again, I had the misfortune of doing an end block resection at Tata. And 2 years later, he died. So he died, I think, last year, this kid. So he lived like 8-9 years after this surgery. And he was normal neurology. So just to wake you up and give you a shot, the next case could be referred to you.
Thank you. It was very interesting, yes, sir. So I think the time is short. The last question to Dr. Ranjit and Dr. V.K. Sinha from Dr. Abhishek, that tandem stenosis, where to operate first?
Sinha, sir.
Dr. Ranjit and Dr. Sinha.
So if I can answer that, tandem stenosis, so it's always what the patient comes with. If patient comes with the lumbar spine symptoms and you pick up the cervical spine, you have to tell them that you have to always depend upon which is more severe, operate the cervical first. But generally, they will not be willing because they say that my problem is in the lower down. So at that point of time, when there is more of element spines than human spines, I operate the lumbar spine, telling them that you will get upper limb symptoms in 3 months' time and you have to undergo that. If it is equally severe and both can be dealt in the back, I do both in the same sitting, cervical plus lumbar, same sitting. If it is something which has to be done in the front, lumbar back, cervical front, I do lumbar back after a couple of weeks or when he really asks, go from the front, cervical spine.
I have got experience in a few cases and it has been a paper of mine, double lesions of the spine, in which there could be pathology in the cervical spine as well as in the lumbar spine. The thing that I think and I have practiced is that what is the neural, like upper neural motor neuron disease, then I go for cervical spine first. And if I feel that this lumbar spine is neurology more, then I go for this lumbar spine. And I always tell the patient, something like the block on the highway. There could be block at two places, one at higher level and one at the lower level. If you do, if you jam at the lower level, the higher level will... So therefore, it's the traffic at the higher level. And then I do it... And I think most of the time
that is the criteria you do which to do first.
Yeah.
Yes. So I think the time is getting up and it was a wonderful webinar, wonderful session. Thank you all the presenters. Thank you, Dr. Abhay Nene, Dr. Raghu Prasad, Dr. Ranjit Unnikrishnan, Dr. Gautam, Dr. V.K. Sinha. It was a wonderful time we have. So in the more future, we'll continue this. So thank you. Over to Samsul.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. So learning continues in lockdown at home. Thank you all, sir. It's been a wonderful second webinar by BUA and Ortho Walls, Ortho TV. I would like to give my thanks to our bio secretary, Dr. Rajivanan sir, President Dr. Manoj Chaudhary sir, our esteemed faculty, Dr. Vishwinder Singh sir, Dr. Nene, Dr. Raghu Prasad, Dr. Ranjit, and Dr. Gautam Prasad. I especially thanks Dr. Ashok Shyam, the wonder man behind IORG and Ortho TV for this amazing event. Hope you all enjoyed. We'll be back again. We have our next Assam India Ortho Walls, Ortho TV webinar on principle of infected non-union on Sunday 7 p.m. So we'll be ending the webinar and the live now. If any of the faculty or the panelists want to say something about, please request them.
Stay safe, stay at home.
Especially Ranjit. Dr. Ranjit.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank
sir.
You.
I'm ending the live webinar, right. Sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. The live webinar is off. We are ending the meeting now, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.